other than what was said in the blurb, other than what was said in the blurb about the in the announcement, but just to say that we are very delighted that Ambassador Nazareth could be here with us. He's a very distinguished former diplomat, and after diplomat being his career in diplomacy, which in which he was ambassador in
just
many
open
countries,
that bag and bring out the books, it will take
a he has become deeply involved with Gandhiism, and so he this is his second book on Gandhi. His first book was
also
on Gandhi's outstanding leadership,
books.
Which has been translated in multiple languages in India and outside. Apart from his work on those books, he's also a founder and managing trustee of the Sarvodaya International Trust, which is promoted to dedicated to promoting Gandhian ideas.
Just take it out and leave it.
U Thant Award.
Keep them
in
here.
2007. So with that, today we'll talk about his second book, which is called Gandhi, the Soul Force Warrior. It's about Gandhi's approach to social change, and we're delighted to have Ambassador Nazareth here.
Good afternoon, dear friends. I have been looking forward for many years to come to this university, and today I was all ready since morning to come. They arranged an Ola taxi. I have no faith in Ola taxi. The Ola taxi arrived. I requested 12:45. It was parked. I found about 50 feet away, not in front of our house, and it took us some time to find it. We finally found it, and by the time we found it, apparently he got some instruction from his head office to say there was too much of delay, so this thing is cancelled, so not to proceed. So right before our eyes, we found him leaving. So I had then quickly to order something from my own car company, and we got here. But by the time the car company arrived and I got here, we have lost 40 minutes. My great regret over that. Now, before I speak about my books, I should tell you how I got involved with writing about Gandhi in my old age. It was mainly because as a young officer in the Foreign Service, I had gone all over the world proudly proclaiming that religious tolerance was India's gift to the world. Ekam sat vipraha bahudavada. In the latter years of my life, when I saw the terrible things happening in my country, what happened, for instance, to Graham Staines and his two children, what happened to the Sikhs after the assassination, Indira Gandhi assassination, I felt really, I couldn't believe it was my own country, and I felt something needed to be done. Everyone kept saying that, oh, India is going to the dogs. When I was young, an old aunt of mine had told me that it's always better to light one little candle than to curse the darkness. So I decided I was going to do whatever I could, whether I succeed or not. Well, I didn't know and I didn't mind, so I decided to write this book called Gandhi's Outstanding Leadership. To show how this man, an amazing case study, in his youth he was so very timid. He has a degree, a British degree from London. He comes back, anyone else with a British legal degree would have been strutting around like a peacock. This man goes to court with his first case, and he arrives in court and is trembling all over. Yeah, and he has forgotten everything that he had read. And he writes in his book that everyone was laughing at me in the court, but there was nothing he could do except to return the brief to the poor old lady who had given it to him. He never went back to court. So when he got an invitation to go to South Africa, where he was only supposed to help in translating Gujarati legal documents into English, because it was a quarrel between two Gujarati Muslim cousins about some property dispute in India, that he went there. He's there just 1 week. He's on his way from Durban to Johannesburg. He gets thrown out of a train. Not because he's caused any disturbance, not because he has not got a ticket, but because with a brown skin, he's sitting in a first-class compartment. So he gets thrown out. And then something happens to him, amazing. And it not only changes his life, I believe it has changed world history. His first temptation is to leave this country and to go. But then he says, no, that would be cowardice. And he asks, what is my duty? Amazing. 24-year-old young man is not worried that his rights have been greatly injured, but he wants to know, what is my duty? Why does he say that? This is where the spiritual inputs in him become pertinent. His most important spiritual input was the Bhagavad Gita. What is the message of the Bhagavad Gita? That when you are faced with evil and injustice, you have no option. Your duty is to stand up and to confront it. Even if the evil and injustice that you see is located in your own family or your own brother, you have to stand up and confront it, whether you succeed or it doesn't. But there's another important input also. Because there are many other inputs, non-violence from the Jains, justice from the Quran. But the other important input is from the Bible, from the Sermon on the Mount, that you must conquer with love. What's the message of Christ? Love one another as I have loved you. In the Sermon on the Mount, it is written that the meek will inherit the earth. So the element of self-suffering in Gandhi's satyagraha is directly an input from Christ. Through the crucifixion, the redemption will come. Now, it is the combination of the message of Krishna and the message of Christ which makes Gandhi such a powerful and a revolutionary figure. So the transformation that has come about in Gandhi was what really got me interested in sort of researching about the man. How this very timid man in his youth then becomes the most fearless leader. In fact, his motto later becomes, he who fears fails. So the first thing to do in non-violent struggle is to give up fear. And his famous quotation, they may imprison me, they may torture me, they might break my bones, they may even kill me. But then they would have my dead body, they wouldn't have my consent. So the victory is still mine. Now, so this is what therefore got me started, and I decided to write this book because I felt India needed Gandhi at that time and his whole approach to the solution of problems of non-violent conflict resolution. Not in my wildest dreams did I ever imagine it would achieve the success it has. It has come out, it was published in 2006. By now, it has come out in 12 Indian languages and 23 foreign languages, including Mandarin. That is the amazing thing. There was no book published on Gandhi for 50 years because Gandhi was persona non grata in China. Why? Because Mao had said that power grows out of the barrel of a gun. Gandhi said, no, it grows out of the strength of the human spirit. If you stand up for the truth, and for Gandhi, truth was God. If you stand up for the truth, then you're putting God on your side. So you cannot lose. Because by definition, God cannot lose. Of course, you might not live to see the success of your cause. But that is not important. The important thing is the cause, and the cause must succeed. So this was his whole approach to life. It came out in Mandarin. It has come out in Arabic, in German, in French, in Dutch, in Russian, in Portuguese. The last thing it came out was in Greek, published in Cyprus. The latest is a proposal to bring it out in Thai, in Thailand. So this was absolutely amazing. However, I had kept updating it as we go along. Then I reached a point and I said, instead of updating it, I would like to write a sequel to it. The sequel is the book that was published and released in December of last year. It's called Gandhi, the Soul Force Warrior, who revolutionized revolution and spiritualized it. It's rather a bold, bold and ambitious title. Why did I write it? Why did I give this the title? Because the 20th century was the century of revolutions. Every type of revolution you could imagine: fascist revolution, communist revolution, national socialist revolutions. All the revolutions triggered with hate and accompanied with enormous violence. Hate is very important for these revolutions because that is the trigger. Unless you can create hate against a certain group of people, in fact, you cannot, you know, trigger revolution. So hate is a very important element. Now, in this century, when all this is happening, this man in South Africa, it was incidentally the first 9/11. It was the 9/11 of 1906 that Gandhi enunciated his Satyagraha. Satyagraha is the Indian word for it, commonly used. But the real name for it is soul force. And Martin Luther King always used soul force instead of Satyagraha, because if you use Satyagraha, the Americans wouldn't understand what he was saying. But he has also used two other names to describe his revolution. It is love force, and it is, he also calls it a thought revolution. And his basic argument is, if you can change people's minds, you can change everything. You can even change the hate-filled, violence-prone revolutionary into a soul force revolution. In fact, this is what he has written in his first book, in Swaraj, in which he says that he wrote it as an answer to the Indian school of violence. And he makes the point that you have to admit that the revolutionary has got a heroic component in him. You know, without the element of heroism, the willingness to die for his cause, in fact, you know, he couldn't be a revolutionary. So his whole approach is, and he writes this, is to convert the hate-filled, violence-prone revolutionary into a soul force revolution, a revolutionary of love. And the two words that he has used to bring about all the change that he did, first in South Africa and then in this country. He arrived in India in 1915. By 1947, India was free, just 32 years. And it's the most amazing thing you could imagine, with two words: truth and nonviolence, two sides of one coin. And by nonviolence, he really meant love. Because if you really love someone, you cannot be violent towards that person. This is the revolution that he has made. When I and if you think of the great achievement, when he came, there was a very well established school of militant school in India, violence. Both in India and in London, these young, very patriotic people went around killing British officials, thinking that by killing British officials in London, in here, there, everywhere in India, that they would frighten the British and they would leave. Now, one thing is very obvious in all these things: if an oppressed people picks up the gun, you can be sure that your oppressor always will have a smarter gun and a better gun and a gun that will fire more bullets. So only you will get your bullets in the chest. Nothing will happen to the other. So the most foolish thing for an oppressed people to do is to pick the gun. That is Gandhi realized early. So he had to decide to change the rules of the game, which he did in a brilliant manner. What was the thing? The first thing he did was that non-cooperation. We're not going to cooperate with them. He saw very well that the British were in India not because they loved Indians. The British were in India in order to make profit, to sell their goods, and in order to get our raw materials, you know, and add to their wealth. We got a large market. So here's a simple logic. We won't buy their goods. And the largest import, British import into India was textiles from practically nothing in 100 years. Paul Kennedy has pointed this out in preparing for the 21st century. It went from practically nothing into more than 100 million yards. So Gandhi said, we will spin our own cloth. We have cotton in this country. We grow the cotton. Why should we export it to London? We will make our own cloth. We will spin the cotton. We will make the yarn. We will use the charkha. When he proposed the charkha, he has confessed in his autobiography, he hadn't even seen a charkha. He had only heard about it. But he decided that this will be the antidote for all India's poverty, and it will be the armament of India's national struggle. That was the only physical armament that he had. He said, we will make our own cloth. We'll spin our own cloth, make our own cloth. It won't be the smartest cloth in the world, but it will be good enough. It'll keep us warm. It'll cover our nudity and let us wear it with dignity. And they made that cap. And to wear the cap became the great badge of defiance. Those days, apparently, you could be arrested for just wearing the cap. What an amazing thing. And also just see the man's brilliance by selecting the charkha, making it compulsory for everyone in the national movement to spin yarn first thing in the morning. He, in fact, brought in equality among all the people fighting for freedom. Whether you were studied in Oxford or Cambridge, or whether you were a scavenger, involved in the national movement, everyone had to spin cotton. And they had to spin it all sitting together. What an amazing way of bringing equality in a country riddled with inequality and all types of, caste differences. In 32 years, he brought Britain to its knees. In fact, in 1930, at the great, salt march, in fact, a lot of scholars claim that it was on that day that India actually became free, because it broke the spell of fear that with which Britain had held India. And then when he started from Sabarmati Ashram, there were only 76 people with him. By the time he got to Dundee, there were almost 30,000 people. All along the way, people sort of joined his. But they made salt not only in Dundee. On that day, salt was made all over the 4,000 miles of Indian coast. There was no way the British could, they tried to arrest many of them. How can you arrest, maybe 5, 6, 8 million people? That was the day India really became free psychologically. It was an amazing achievement. And think of Gandhi's achievement. He has inspired, aroused, mobilized millions of people. He has fundraised for them. He has negotiated on their behalf, led them through all these struggles for 32 years, and given them what they wanted. And amazingly, Gandhi had said, non-violent struggle is not a program for seizure of power. It's an effort to bring about a transformation of relationship. And that's what happened. In leaving, British were not driven out of the country, but they left as friends. In fact, the British historian has made the point, Arnold Toynbee, that Gandhi was as much a friend of the British as he was of India, of Britain as he was of India. He made it impossible for us to continue ruling India, but he made it possible for us to leave India with dignity and without rancor. That is the whole Gandhian approach. Now, this is what I have dealt with in my first book of his leadership, how he was transformed from this very timid young youth into the fearless leader he became, and how he brought about major change in India. And just think of what the change is. Almost overnight, between 46 and 47, India, which had been a minimally democratic country, ridden with caste, feudalism, every form of difference in wealth and in social position, is overnight transformed into a democracy based on universal adult franchise. Everyone, Oxford or Cambridge educated, the last cabin, is equal before the law. Untouchability, which has lasted in India for at least 3,000 years, is abolished overnight. You can't abolish it, of course, you know, in reality, something which has lasted so long. But legally, you make it illegal. No one can practice it. And then also imagine a highly feudal country, 560 rajas and maharajas, big ones like the one in Hyderabad and Kashmir and one, maybe one of Travancore was also fairly big. Overnight, you know, have gone overnight or within a year, all their states are integrated to the country. No one's head is chopped off. Think of what happened in the French Revolution. How much that guillotine had to go up and down before liberty, equality, and fraternity was established. The most amazing thing you could imagine anywhere. When I spoke at the Asian Institute of Management in Manila, I described this as the greatest management achievement of the 20th century. Absolutely incredible. So this is all contained in my first book. Now in my second book, I've dealt mainly with revolutions. What actually the thinking on revolutions from earliest times, from Aristotle, you know, onwards, various people and how they have defined revolution. I have analyzed two of the most important revolutions of the modern age, the French Revolution and the American Revolution. What is the difference between them? The French Revolution was full of idealism. You know, they brought down a king, but in the end got an emperor. Napoleon, who was the one who created all this revolution, you know, they brought down the king, they guillotined him, and finally Napoleon crowned himself emperor. Much of Europe was conquered. 3 million people apparently were killed in all these wars. Great glory of France didn't last more than 15 years. The American Revolution was much more sedate. There was, of course, killing there, etc. But, you know, it didn't go through the horrors and the brutalities of the French Revolution. But all the other revolutions since then, the brutal ones and the non-violent ones, there's a whole new genre of revolution that have been created. All of them have been given very lovely flowery names. One is called the Jasmine Revolution, another one is called, you know, something else and something else, and one is called the Cedar Revolution of Lebanon, I think. Various others. India is called the Soul Force Revolution. And it's amazing to think of the cost of these two types of revolution. Now, on the violent side, in the 20th century, in all the revolutions that have gone through, and the two world wars and others, almost 90 million people have been killed in 100 years. And we call this civilization. What an amazing measure of this. In the last war, just to get rid of three dictators, Mussolini in Italy, Hitler in Germany, and Togo in Japan, 50 million people have been killed. You know, cities destroyed, men, women, children absolutely massacred all over. You know, and the worst outrage of all was two atom bombs dropped on Nagasaki and Hiroshima. Now, in all the non-violent revolutions which have taken place, and in which, because of which, in various parts of the world, more than 150 countries have been liberated. When India became free and joined the United Nations, it was the 37th member of the United Nations. Very few independent people in the countries in those days, except for Latin America and the European countries. All the others had been colonies. And that is the amazing thing. even when I grew up, the map of the world was all in five colors. Pink for the British, green for the French, blue, I think, for the Belgians, and you know, one or two other colors. Everything else was covered in these colors. And then, within 50 years of India's independence, 120 countries became independent. It is the most major transformation of global political geography there has ever been. And honestly, it all started with Gandhi. Because once people learn that an unarmed people who are united, who are willing to suffer and die for their cause, but never to kill, they have learned a great lesson. This is what happened. Of course, the other thing that happened was, once India became independent, once the brightest jewel was plucked from the British crown, the will to hold on to other small colonies, you know, was broken, number one. Number two, it became more and more expensive to hold on to these colonies, because every day there was, you know, some uprising somewhere. So all of a sudden, not only that, but in the United Nations, where India led the whole struggle for decolonization, you know, colonialism no longer became respectable. Until then, it was widely believed that colonialism was a civilizing mission. The white man had to go all over the world, you know, to teach primitive peoples how to live, how to dress, how to wear, how to eat with fork and spoon, you know, how to have smart sanitary fittings. If you go to the big palaces in Rajasthan, Jaipur, Udaipur, and others, I was amazed to see every single toilet fitting is Royal Doulton. Can you imagine? People in the country are starving, and our dear Rajas and Maharajas are importing all this. India actually was certainly impoverished by the British, but it was as much or almost as much impoverished by our own Rajas and Maharajas. The worst type of feudalism you could imagine in this country. All this is sort of removed almost overnight. Now, to get rid of these three dictators I mentioned, we have lost more than 50 million people. Now, in all the non-violent revolutions that have taken place, which have liberated so many countries, brought down all the communist dictatorships in Eastern Europe, brought down the Marcos dictatorship in France, the ended apartheid in South Africa, racial discrimination in the US, the Pinochet regime over there. Of course, people have died. But to add them all up, it doesn't even add up to 50,000 people. Compare 50 million with 50,000. That is the difference between the two types of revolutions. That is why I have said, and I think I have justifiably said, that Gandhi revolutionized revolution. What was such a bloody, hate-filled revolution was made without hate and without violence. Now, why do I say that he spiritualized? Because he anchored his revolution firmly in truth, which for him was God. By doing so, in fact, he spiritualized revolution. In order to be a Gandhi type of revolution, a soul force revolution, you needed nothing except a firm faith in God. To say that if I stand up for the truth, I will succeed. God is with me. And Gandhi, in his whole approach to religion, also made one other very great contribution. By aligning himself, anchoring himself firmly in the truth, he raised religion to the level of spirituality. In fact, Gandhi has said, "My religion transcends Hinduism." He was a deeply devout Hindu. And yet he has said this, "My religion transcends Hinduism and binds me firmly to the truth." By doing so, he has raised religion, you know, common man's religion, to the level of spirituality. And he has readily said that in every religion, there are certainly a great element, core of truth, but there are also, you know, because they are human institutions handled by humans, there will be also impurities or dross, which sort of, you know, comes into it. And he had refused to admit that the caste system was an integral part of Hinduism. He said it was brought in later on, and he held this to the very end. And in fact, he has said, if anyone can prove to me that that the caste system is an essential part of the Hindu religion, that he would be the first, you know, to attack it. So now his raising religion to the level of spirituality, by doing so, he has made a great contribution. Because one of the great tragedies of the modern world, as we all know, the worst types of violence are being perpetrated in the name of religion. You only have to say that my religion is in danger, or someone is endangering my religion, and you can mobilize a whole lot of people. It has become the best form of social mobilization anywhere in the world. Many people imagine that it all started with the Muslims. Not true at all. It started with the Christians. In fact, the word fundamentalism came out of America. Why? You know, when Darwin's theory was enunciated, it caused a great deal of commotion in America. They couldn't believe. They said, it is written in the Bible that God created it, Adam, Eve, you know, the Garden of Eden, etc. How can this, the Bible can't be wrong. So there was a great sort of thing. It went up to the Supreme Court and various things. Now there was one American millionaire called Mr. Moody in Chicago who gave $1 million to bring out apparently 12 or 16 tracts, you know, on various aspects of the essentials of the Christian faith, the fundamentals of the Christian faith. And those books were then sent to all the public libraries in the country. This is how the word fundamentalism started in the first instance. Then, of course, it went to all the other religions, certainly came into Islam, went into Buddhism, Judaism, Zionism is all sort of a form of that. But sadly, it's also come into Hinduism, the most tolerant of all religions in the world. And for me, Hinduism is the most amazing of all religions, not just the most tolerant. It is the only religion which is a cosmology, which explains not only God and man and the relation between the two, but with God and all his creation. Can you imagine? The Dashavatar is Darwin 3,000 years before Darwin. Isn't it amazing? Shankara speaks about you know, the Mahashakti Advaita. This was proved by Einstein only at the beginning of this century, that everything that you see is a manifestation of the Mahashakti, whether it's the star that shines, a flower that blooms, a bird that sings, a child that is born. The fact that your heart beats every moment, you are not doing it yourself. Someone is doing it. That someone is the Mahashakti. This is the only thing that makes sense. And only Hinduism has found these great secrets. And the amazing thing for me is, how have the Hindu sages found it? By looking into the microcosmos, they have discovered the truths of the macrocosmos. Now, Gandhi was certainly an Advaitin, you know, and he believed that. He has gone to meet to the Belur Mutt. He has met the leading monks there, and had a great respect for Swami Vivekananda. Now, by raising religion to the level of spirituality, Gandhi has made this great contribution to the modern world by introducing spirituality and raising religion to the level of spirituality. I believe it all began with him. Today, it is being greatly promoted by various people, but mainly by His Holiness the Dalai Lama. Dalai Lama has a simple message. I have the great good fortune of knowing him personally. In fact, he has written the foreword to this book of mine. For 5 years, I was the chairman of the Indo Tibetan Friendship Association of South India. There are 50,000 Tibetans in and around Karnataka. And every year when he came to meet them on their on his annual visits, I used to receive him in the airport. And we have stayed in touch. And he has a simple message. He says, you want to be happy, make others happy. There is no need of great temples and churches and so and so. Our own body is a temple because the supreme energy resides here. We can create a heaven on earth right here by being kind and compassionate to each other. So in this book of mine, I have also shown Gandhi's impact on the world, much more than in my first book. And I've presented a whole lot of them. And the two maybe of these things I would like to present to you. One is of this woman called Rosa Parks. On the 5th of December of 1955, she refused to give up her seat on a bus to a white man. Now the rule in the law in Montgomery and all the southern states was that in a public bus, all the blacks would sit behind. Well, first they had to pay their fare, so they would enter through the front, give their fare to the chauffeur, then get out of the bus, go through the back entrance and sit in the back seat. The whites would enter through the front and sit in the front seat. Now, if all the front seats were filled and another white man got in, then it was necessary for the black one behind to get up and give the seat to the white man. Mind you, all of them are paying the same fare. Just think of the injustice of this. Now, this woman must have been about 30 or 32. A simple, anonymous woman. She was described as a seamstress. In India, we would call her a tailor. Apparently, her job was to stitch buttons on shirts in a department store. She was, at that moment, the secretary of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored Women in Montgomery. So she obviously knew about Gandhi. And because among the blacks, Gandhi was fairly well known. So she refused to give up her seat. She knew what the consequences would be. She was pushed out of the bus. She was charged with disorderly conduct. She was taken to court, arrested, taken to court, fined $50, and apparently put in jail for 2 weeks or something. Now, just at that time, Martin Luther King, also just 24 or 25, just been ordained as a Baptist minister, has arrived in Montgomery. He has also read about Gandhi. So he decides on a simple thing. He said, let's make a bus boycott. What do they decide? That none of them would ride a bus. Even if they had to walk for 10 miles, they will not ride a bus. Those who had taxis decided to give free rides, rides to the others in their thing, charging them the same fare as they would pay for the bus. This went on for one whole year. The Montgomery Bus Company went bankrupt. Because you can't run a bus service with only whites riding it, because most whites have cars. In the meantime, this became a national issue. It went up to the Supreme Court, and this thing started on the 5th of December, maybe by the 15th, little more than 1 year, a year and 10 days or something. The Supreme Court decided for all over the country that no discrimination based on color was permitted in any public transport. Later on, they also extended it to public places like toilets and restaurants and others. Now, it began with this simple black woman. But then it was carried forward nationally by Martin Luther King. It became spread all over the country. It took 55 years. But what was the end result? A black president in the White House. Incredible, I must say. And when he took his oath of office, he said, that is the amazing thing about America, a nonviolent struggle, that my father would not have been served, in any of the southern restaurants. Today, I'm taking the oath of office. Now, it started with this one single woman, a black woman, you know, refusing to give up his tea. That simple little thing triggered a whole revolution. And that is it. When she died, her body is kept in the rotunda in Washington for 3 whole days so that everyone could come and pay their respect to her. Today she is described as the mother of the American freedom movement. A statue of hers, you know, is in the, what is called the National Statuary. Amazing. These are some of the soul force warriors. The other one example I would give you is that of a man called Evo Morales. An ordinary, maybe semi-literate cocoa farmer in Bolivia, one of the most remote countries in the world. Bolivia has practically nothing except natural gas. And all of this was being taken by the multinational companies for a pittance, you know, royalty of 10 or 15%. He then led, like Gandhi, salt march, a march from his hometown of Cochabamba to La Paz, the capital. And he had a simple demand. He said, you just tell the multinational companies to, instead of 10 or 15%, to make it 50%. That balance that you are getting, what we demanded, use in order to build housing, schools, and others for us. The government in office refused, refused that. So then he continued his agitation, and it grew in number, so much so that the government fell. A new government took over, and then they were forced to raise the royalty to 50%. In the next election, Evo Morales ran, and because he succeeded in raising the thing to 50%, he was elected president. The first time in 500 years that an Aymara, that's a local Indian, is elected president of the country. He's still the president of the country. So I give you these two examples. There are many others like this in this book, where nonviolent struggle works. Of course it doesn't. It's not like an instant solution. It takes time. It requires patience. And it requires a strategy. You need to train people on how to do it. Well, I'm hoping that this book will also make an impact on, I don't know whether they'll be as successful as the first, but I certainly feel happy with with whatever responses I've got as of now, and I'm very, very happy that I have the opportunity of speaking to all of you here today. I'm deeply grateful to this Mahaguru of yours, whom I've known for a long time, who kindly arranged this meeting here. I'll stop here. I don't know how much of time you have, if any of you wishes to ask any question. I would just like to, this book has been brought out with two separate covers, because the first one came out in 35 different languages. We decided to bring this out in two. This was the one I selected, Gandhi at Dundee, which I describe as, which I feel strongly is the most revolutionary act. My editor preferred this. He said, you don't even see Gandhi's face in this. So he decided to chose this face. I described this Gandhi with the Mona Lisa smile. So it has been brought out in these two covers. Now this is the cover of my first book, which this I believe is the best sculpture, best depiction of leadership I've seen anywhere, where Gandhi here, and there are 12 people following him, first one of whom is a woman, and then a whole lot of others, including a Christian pastor, who was his great disciple. And all the 35 editions of my book has the same cover. I insisted on this. In certain cases, they made color changes in the rest of it, but no one was allowed to change this particular illustration of leadership. So Gandhi is a wonderful case study of leadership. Is there time for questions?
We have two copies extra if you wanted to buy.
Oh, incidentally, one other thing I want to say. Besides being a founder, managing trustee of the Sarvodaya International Trust, I was recently requested to take over as chairman of the Gandhi Center for Science and Human Values of Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, who have published a number of books. In fact, This book originally, the original 2006 edition of this book was published by the Gandhi Center. And if they had not published it, maybe it would never have been published, because Sarvodaya International Trust knew nothing about publishing books. We didn't even know what an ISBN number was. So it was Professor Srikantan, my predecessor, was the one who kindly said it was a good book and decided to publish it, agreed to publish it. So when he asked me to take over, I'm 83 years old already. He said he was very old, he is 92. I told him I was not much younger. But since he asked me and he had published my first book, I could hardly say no. So I took over from him. Now the Gandhi Center has published a number of books on human values, on science, on astronomy, etc. I've made a package of these and I'm presenting it to you, to your library. Yeah, okay. Will you accept them, please? Thank you.
And very soon.
And one of my Gandhi Soul Force Warrior books is also in this year. If any of you has a question, I'd be happy to answer it. Yes?
My question is about you're a diplomat, and generally diplomats are not very fascinated by Gandhi, as far as I've heard. If I was a diplomat, I would have been fascinated by Bismarck or maybe Sardar Patel. Why Gandhi? Why not them?
Yeah, you would be surprised. You know, when I traveled over the world, this is part of the reason also I decided to write, particularly after I became ambassador, reached the level of ambassador, I was absolutely amazed. In every country I went, at the highest level, president, prime minister, foreign minister, university president, they all spoke with such a reverence of Gandhi. This is what struck me. In all these countries, I met President Carter. He was not president then, but you know, he was much involved with Habitat for Humanity, and we did a fundraiser for them in New York when I was the president of the Society of Foreign Consul. So I was struck by this, and it struck me that here is the whole of the world, you know, with such a great reverence for this man, and India, we have sort of found all the other Gandhis we could found, and have enthroned all of them. That is part of the reason why I decided to write this book, to tell my own fellow countrymen what Gandhi's impact on the world is. And this is one of the main Gandhians in this country who have spent their whole life promoting Gandhi know absolutely nothing about Gandhi's impact on the world. So therefore, it all depends on diplomats and others. There are, I know, a number of them. It is the he's the greatest soft power asset India has. Even when I met Prime Minister Modi, when the Gujarati edition of my book came, I wrote to him. And I also told him this has been published by the Navjeevan Trust, which Gandhiji had founded. I'd like to come and give this. He graciously received me. And he told me on that occasion that not many realized Gandhi is the greatest soft power asset we have. So diplomats who are aware, of course, now things have changed. They are now not only promoting Sardar Patel, they are promoting Savarkar. Sadly, anyway, I don't think many abroad are going to buy it. You know, you can try to promote something, but you know, when you try to market a good, it must be saleable. Yeah.
He's criticized for being two-faced, because if you hear Ambedkar's speech in with the CNN back in New York, so in one of his interviews, he says that Gandhi used to run a lot of different newspapers in different languages, and if you read the content of one newspaper on a particular day, he would be taking one stance which is in favor of the Indians and one stance which is in favor of the British. So he was playing the Indians. So anywhere in your book do you defend his?
In my book, in the last chapter, it's titled Assessments of Gandhi's Revolutionary Ideology and Achievement. The first part of it is all with criticisms of him, of the worst types, including of his own assassin. Godse's thing is carried in it. Ambedkar's is carried in it, because you should know both sides of the coin. So I've given all of them. Then I've also given those who have spoken in favor of him. And I've left it to people to decide, you know, which one outweighs the other. It's very important. The worst you can do just is to praise a man without saying what is being said about him. Now, I have a great regard for Gandhi, but I'm quite sure he was not the best husband or the best father in the world. I think he made a big mistake, for instance, suddenly declaring the Quit India movement in the middle when the Japanese are on India's doorsteps. By doing so, all the Congress leadership was imprisoned and Jinnah got the entire platform free to himself. So Gandhi has certainly made mistakes. But the thing I would say is the following. You know, Gandhi is not Jesus Christ or any of the incarnation. Gandhi is like any of us. The only difference was that he was born in a more prosperous family than me or you maybe. So he had the chance of being sent to England at a time when very few could go there. That's the only difference. Now the fact that someone like him with all his imperfections could achieve so much and receive such heights is what makes him so much more inspiring to me. In the case of Jesus Christ, well, he was born a God, he knew everything, he could do nothing wrong, etc., etc., etc. I'm a Christian. That's what I'm supposed to believe. So Gandhi is more relevant to me than Christ. And amazingly for me, I believe I'm today a much better Christian because I read Gandhi. Gandhi is the first person to show, and his great Christian disciple has written about it. He said Gandhi is the first one to show that the Sermon on the Mount can actually be lived in the practice, that it is not some sort of, you know, idealism up there in the sky. That's really true. That Christ and the Christian thing can actually be lived in practice. And, you know, we are always talking about hellfire. For me, Christ's message is simple, much closer to what Gandhi or the Dalai Lama was. Love one another as I have loved you. Yeah. Yes?
So I want to know that how Gandhi is relevant in modern India these days, where villages were important for Gandhi, where villages these days are struggling for basic food, health, education, shelter. So how Gandhi's philosophy is relevant in today's India? Have we forgotten his ideologies and he's only in pictures, or how we should revive his philosophies actually?
Two things that Gandhi said and stood for is most relevant in India today. Gandhi's advice to India's leaders of independent India was a simple one. He said, whenever you are considering some, you know, course of action, try to recall the face of the poorest man or woman that you have seen and ask yourself whether the step that you are contemplating will do some good to that person. So his focus was on the poorest of the poor, whom he called the dumb millions of India, number one. On the other hand, he was very, very keen that people, that religion was something between you and your creator. Between you and your state, there should be nothing but your citizenship. That all of us in this land and on this earth are brothers. You would say that in heaven there are no religions. There is only a father and there are his children of various colors. If there is color in heaven. I think that is what is most relevant in India today. Sadly, there is no focus on the poorest of the poor. You know, the one thing which I thought finally this government was doing was to sort of put that some sort of a tax on the super rich. Then all of a sudden a whole lot of money got pulled out. Now that tax has been removed. So, you know, that money will come back and the rich now will continue to make money in the millions. So it's like, it's become like a disco. This is the wrong approach. I mean, there are enormous problems in India. Look at the state of our farmers. You know, a whole lot of the unemployed youth in the country. A whole lot of people have lost their jobs in the agricultural sector, in the small industry sector, everywhere. I'm afraid that we are in for a major financial debacle. And worst of all, I'm sure he will agree with me, the most dangerous thing to do is to go and borrow on foreign markets, because you're borrowing in foreign currency. And already within the last 3 months, the rupee has dropped from 68 to 72. So every drop in the value of the rupee, your foreign debt burden goes up. It's really like a noose around your neck. The RBI has been drained of all its reserves. Where that money is going, I don't know. So we are in a dangerous situation. So we've got to get down to basics. Unless we think of the poorest of the poor, how what you are doing is affecting them. People only talk about the rate of economic growth. It is possible, as it's happened in many countries, where you're showing high rates of growth, but all the growth, all the benefits of the growth are only going to people with wealth. They are only increasing wealth. Man with no land, with no money to... People today can't even buy a packet of biscuits. There are reports about this. A 5 rupee packet of biscuit has become too expensive for a whole lot of people. And when we talk about, you know, having a $5 billion economy, $5 trillion economy, this is, I'm afraid, rather foolish talk. So Gandhi is very, very necessary. And the other thing I would also say is, there has been obviously a great rise in intolerance in the country, mainly against the Muslim community. People are just being lynched, also against the Christian. Now, if you look at the long history of India, all our golden ages was when there was religious tolerance. The moment we got an Aurangzeb was the beginning of the end. The great Mughal Empire, which covered so much of the country and really provided, I believe, very excellent governance in the country. All over, and a lot of scholars, including British scholars, have written about it. The moment he came in, within 50 years of his coming, entire thing collapsed. And the close unity between the Sikhs, for instance, and the Mughals was broken. 50 years, the entire thing collapsed, and the British, first came in the British, then came in the French and the Portuguese, and the Portuguese were here a little earlier. All the others, and it was gone, and we got 200 years of slavery. So it's a very dangerous situation to bring in any form of division in the country. That is what the long history of India tells us, and we must remember that.
Hello. Sir, can I speak in Hindi? You Jab Gandhi.
Can you come forward here? I'd like to see you, what you look like. Banni, banni, ili banni. Yeah. Thank you. I can see you better now. Yeah. Yes, yes.
We are from same stock. So this is kind of a racist behavior which Gandhi follow, and the title of your book is The Soul Warrior. So it is a little bit contradicting. And Ghana University removed Gandhi's statue from university. So what do you say about this?
Yes. What I would say is what Gandhi himself has said, that, as I said, Gandhi was like any of us. You know, he has grown little by little. When he went to South Africa, the main thing that he saw was the way Indians were being treated. He had come from India, he had studied in England, he had read about Queen Victoria's declaration, you know, when India was taken over, how Indians would be like equal citizens of the... Many things were promised to us in terms of equality, dignity, etc. When he arrived in South Africa, he found the way Indians were being treated. So his concern at that time was not about humanity as a whole. He was worried about the condition of his own people. So he was fighting for his own people. And in fighting for his own people, he was also hurt that the Indians and the Africans were all being lumped together. They were all called coolies. This is what hurt him. No doubt you can say that he was racist, but he saw the difference between the blacks that he saw there, who were completely uneducated, were uneducated also because no one gave them education. So he saw the difference between them and us, and he felt hurt that Indians were being treated like them. Certainly, he should not have, looking back, he should not have used the words that he did. You know, he called them kafirs, which was what the British were calling them. That's certainly wrong. But the fact is, you must not look at something that a man said at a particular period of time, but what he said thereafter. You know, he has grown, he has seen other things, you know, he has risen in stature, both moral and in leadership. And the more he has seen, the more compassionate he has become. So you can't judge the Gandhi at the age of 24, 25 and 30 with the Gandhi of 70. There's a big difference between the two. I'm sure you will see the same difference in yourself now and maybe when you are 50 or 60. Certainly I believe a little more enlightened now than when I was 25 or 30. So we all have to grow. So Gandhi also has grown. He has made his mistakes. We all make mistakes.
Sir, Gandhi also support Varna system and caste system, which divide Indian society in so many groups, which restrict Indian to come together.
Yeah.
So, as Ambedkar said, the caste is did not only do division of labor, but also division of laborer.
Yeah, that's true. That's also a controversial thing on which many people have criticized Gandhi, particularly Arundhati Roy. But I would say the following. The reason, at least one of the important reasons why Gandhi justified caste in its original conception was that it was a specialization of labor. Each one, focused on a certain function and then perfected himself. Now the Brahmins, you can say certainly it's a terrible thing that the Brahmins kept all the knowledge to themselves. I say this too, and one of the things which really amazes me about the Brahmins is they didn't share their knowledge, never mind with the others, they didn't share it even with their wives and daughters. That is what amazes me. Isn't your wife and daughter also a Brahmin? What is it? Only males are Brahmin? No, then. So therefore, that is. But the fact, the good points about it are the following. Now, the Brahmins over the centuries have focused on learning. So they have achieved great heights in learning. In astronomy, for instance, 300 BC, what the Brahmins, our sages, have discovered is really incredible. Some of these I mentioned to you, Dashavatara and others, have all been discovered by our Brahmins many, many centuries before, all because they have spent their entire lives studying the old scriptures, meditating, researching something. The Kshatriyas, similarly, focused on this. Our craftsmen, there's another thing which amazes me in this country, that our greatest craftsmen have all been put among the Shudras. But over a period of time, just by focusing on their art, the sort of art they have developed is difficult to believe, that someone who is completely illiterate can produce such wonderful works of art. Even women's saris, for instance, I am amazed. You can find saris which are worth 50,000, but you can still get a sari. Well, I don't know, they can get a sari for 50 now, you could in the old days, maybe for 200 or 300. And every sari is so well conceived in terms of design and color, so on. Even the poorest of our women, you see them walking and you see how well they are dressed. This is what a whole lot of foreigners tell me. So this, now a dhobi, for instance, my dhobi.
Sir, you are glorifying caste system.
No, I'm not glorifying, I'm telling you. No, one moment. I'm telling you of the advantages of the caste. There are some advantages. So now, in that particular, particularly today, when there is so much of unemployment, even highly educated people can't get a job. My Dobi son has no problem now in getting an earning because he knows his trade. See, a carpenter's son has no job because he's got a trade. These are the only people today with jobs. A whole lot of people with MAs and PhDs, even PhDs, have no jobs. Either they leave the country or some of them are applying for bus conductors. Which would you prefer? So we have to look at both sides of the coin. You know, you can't throw the, as they say, baby out with the bathwater. So the caste system has some advantages over a period of time. It led to specialization. In theory, it's certainly good that everyone must have, you know, the freedom to select whatever job you want. But you then have to see what is the practical reality. Are there jobs for everyone?
But when actually we see this caste system, the feature of caste system is that the upper caste, especially Brahmin, there are power only to some group of people. And in Manusmriti for Shudras, there is a hymn, Ek Mivato Sudrasya Prabhu Karma Samadhishat, ki bas tino varno ki seva karne ke liye aapko Brahma ne create kiya hai. So this is only one side which we look at advantages. But there are so many disadvantages.
No, there are many disadvantages.
There is no social mobility in the caste system.
These days I can tell you there are a lot of disadvantages even for the Brahmins. I've met a lot of Brahmins who are complaining that they wish that they would have some reservations on grounds of poverty. Isn't it true? Haven't you come across many of them?
No, but I thought you made the other statement that Gandhi towards the end said rejected caste.
He rejected caste.
That's something you have to figure out.
Yeah.
Whether or not there was a transition in Gandhi's mind and what is his final mature position on caste, that's what we need to understand.
But I already mentioned how he had said Gandhi had strongly opposed this. That is why Gandhi made the elimination of untouchability the important other side of the coin of the national movement. And that is one of the great achievements. That's something that they bear for at least 3,000 years, at the time of independence, get banned constitutionally. And a whole lot of positive discrimination measures are given for them. So you have to judge all that in this. So don't just accuse Gandhi of favoring as Ambedkar did, which Ambedkar I believe was not very fair. Yeah, I think this young lady has something to ask.
Sir,
yeah.
You said Ambedkar was not fair. So he is asking which one, how he is not fair.
Ambedkar, as you will see in my book, has described Gandhi as the most dishonest man alive. And he said that he had got, God on his lips and something in his heart, a poison in his heart or something to that effect. Which is what he said. I've recorded it in my book. I don't think he was fair on that. Whatever Gandhi's faults might have been, I don't think he was the most dishonest man alive.
Sir, what?
One moment. This lady, I think, young lady. Wants.
So I know there are a couple of questions in my mind as well, but I think instead of focusing on the negatives, we have this tendency of getting fixated on the negatives and don't see the evolution. I would try to focus more on the positive side.
Yes.
I think there are a lot of innovations that Gandhi came up with, which is completely unprecedented. Something
yes.
like creating a movement of this scale
yes.
With things like simple plain Dandi Yatra.
Yeah.
That's amazing. I mean, that's like a lesson for even today for people who are into marketing, branding and all those things. I mean, they take lessons from that kind of movement building and even for the social movements, if you're trying to build social movements.
I'm so glad to hear you say that, yeah.
So on the movement building side, if you can highlight some of his innovations and something that we can really take lessons from. I really get very inspired by the Dandi Yatra kind of stuff that he did, the Satyagraha, the non-cooperation. Any specifics that from your research that has come out and if you can highlight?
For me, his greatest innovation was the charkha, that he selected the charkha. And with the charkha, he served more than one purpose. Number one, it was the beginning of the economic boycott of British goods by making our own cloth. But that also was his antidote for employment in the villages. He said that, when the rains come and, it's planting time, etc., people have work. maybe for 4 months and the rest of the time they have no work. How do you create work for them? So this was a way of doing work. Now you can spin the cloth and make cloth right through the year. This was a very major innovation and no one had thought, and he, I think he was ridiculed most for this one thing, that he is now thinking of the charka when, you know, people is going into the modern age and he's thinking of the charka. But it is because of the charka that India's traditional industries, all of them got revived. Today, 5 billion is the total of all the various items exported, from simple handicrafts to the most expensive carpets all over the world. There are, I'm told, there are at least 30 million families who are involved in these jobs. And all over now, the West, with particularly the coming of artificial intelligence, the whole lot of jobs are just going to disappear. Just by bringing in drones now, all the chauffeurs, delivery boys, everything going to lose jobs. I'm told that the entire nursing profession will disappear because they will have robot nurses. How do you deal with a situation like this? You know, you have educated people all over with no jobs. Now they're talking about a universal basic income. People sit at home and the government is just going to pay them money. What an absurd situation. Now, even today, the jobs that Gandhi created this way, first of all, it revived our industry, our traditional industry, which really is the mark of India. India is recognized all over for all the beautiful things that it does. Even the Gandhian khadi today, there are shops in New York where, when I was in New York, people like Jackie Kennedy used to come and shop. All khadi textiles, but made in silk and various other fabrics. And the most amazing, a whole lot of the top hotels are using these fabrics for all their curtain material or bedspreads, others. So it this sort of innovation, and in fact, one of the things that has been brought up is how Gandhi would have taken to social media. In fact, one of them, I've quoted this man, Roy Kurzweil, I think. He has said Gandhi really would be like the prophet of the postmodern age, because he was a man who specialized in communications at a time when there was no radio, no television, and even if there was, no British man was going to allow him to use it. All his word has been spread by word of mouth and with those little newspapers that he published. Communication is so important. And today, and this is one of the things we have learned today, which people have learned, you know, when the Iraq war was to take place, in 97 or 98 countries all over the world, there were protests to try and stop that war, because it was the most unjust war and a war based on blatant falsehoods. They didn't succeed, but the fact that you could organize people all over the world only through social media, by internet, is a major lesson for us all. Just see what is happening in Hong Kong today. This is the sort of thing we need to learn, because a lot of unjust things are happening in India. My heart goes out to the Kashmiri people. Incidentally, is there anyone from Kashmir in this university? I would like to be introduced very much to him. Because a group of us want to create... Please, you know him? I would be very grateful. We have been looking for this because we want to create a sort of a fund to help Kashmiri students in difficulty today, because they can't contact their parents or they can't get monies from them. I think this is the greatest injustice is happening. I can't believe this has happened in our own country. That overnight, a state disappears from the map of India without even consulting their people. They have got a legislature of their own. They have a constitution of their own. And we say that everything is hunky-dory. You don't allow press to go there. You don't allow anyone to report there. And students can't contact their parents. So we would like to help them, really. I would be very grateful, yes. I answered your question. Thank you so much. There is a lot we can do, really. And the important thing in this whole Gandhian soul first thing is to organize, you know, to be united, to get people together. Yeah. I'm so happy with the interest that all of you are showing in.
This question relates to political philosophy.
Yeah.
Before colonialism, Gandhi led all these protests and he was totally against the British Empire. But in the end, he completely rejected the idea of the state that the British has left us with.
Mm.
So it's a little contradictory, and I fail to understand why would you fight for a state, why would you fight for Swaraj and independence, and in the end reject the complete idea of it and say, we don't want the thing that you've been giving us. So what was exactly Gandhi tried to install, rather than the Nehruvian idea of state and democracy that was imposed by the elite Congress that was there? What was Gandhi actually trying to give us as an alternative?
Yeah, Gandhi was talking about the ideal state, something like Rousseau, you know, the man to nature. That was, of course, the ideal position which he referred to Euclid's line or circle or something. He said, it's something perfect, you will never sort of reach it. In his ideal state, every community will be so sort of independent and self-sufficient, it would not really need a state to overlook them and govern them all. Each one would govern himself. This is an ideal state which is unlikely to pass. But the important thing where India ignored what he said and is paying a heavy price, the difference between Gandhi and Nehru. Gandhi wanted a democracy based on the village and on the village panchayat. And from the village panchayat, he wanted, say, two people or one, whoever number you want, to select people to go to the next higher level, the district panchayat. From the district panchayat to the state panchayat, from the state panchayat to the national panchayat. Now, in every one of these units, from the village to the district to the state, everyone knows everyone else. So they select them on the basis of personal knowledge. We don't need electoral parties and, a very expensive electioneering in order to have an assembly or to have a government. This is where, by selecting the Westminster type of democracy, we are today in the mess we are in. Just see the amount of corruption all over. In every election, there are at least five people who are running in that election. One man wins. But everyone is raising money from somewhere. Isn't that amazing? And having raised that money, the man who elects must get it back. Otherwise, he can't win the next election. Now, not only that, but now today, our politicians are being bought and sold. The latest price, I'm told, here in Karnataka is 40 crores. And obviously, in Delhi, it must be 75 crores. Now, this is the sort of thing we have landed ourselves in. If we had the Gandhian type of democracy, the panchayat type, all this would have been eliminated. And the one person who campaigned a lot for this, incidentally, was my former High Commissioner, B.K. Nehru. He said, we will never eliminate corruption unless we can get rid of this type of democracy. That was Gandhi's main sort of political idea for India. The other one was just, an ideal. In an ideal situation, the sort of polity he would like to have.
And just as you said that Gandhi's idea was the Rousseau's idea of state, but in my head, I related more to Aristotle's polity.
Yeah, sure.
Would you say that Gandhi was actually trying to set up a polity rather than?
In Gandhi's case, you can't pin any one person on him. He has drawn his inspiration from so many people all over. His greatest inspiration, first of all, were the religious books that I've told you. And three religious books he always carried with him, the Bhagavad Gita, the Bible, and the Quran, incidentally. Not many people know this. But he drew his inspiration from many people, from Tolstoy, for instance, from Thoreau, from others, Vivekananda, a whole lot of things. And it's amazing how much he had read. Somewhere I read a list of all the books that Gandhi had read over a period of time. It's really, he has translated Socrates, translated to Gujarati. So it's amazing for me, that to a lawyer with such a deep interest in everything. And the thing which also amazes me is, he had studied law, but had discovered so many things in terms of management, of the environment, and so on and so on. So, so one wonders, how did he discover all this? And my answer to that is, he himself has said that when you dig in the mine of truth, the more you dig and the deeper you go, the more jewels you will find. So by just making a pure pursuit of truth, just applying his mind, his reason, his logic to a practical situation, to what the reality saw on the ground, he discovered enormous things of great worth. He said he was not a philosopher, but I believe that so much of what he has written really is philosophy. Yeah, that's why I've described what you call as a revolutionary ideology, not just as a political philosophy. Yeah.
I think we should be close now.
That we are bringing this to close. One more hand up.
But yeah, but yes,
I have one picture.
Okay, go ahead. Last question.
When Gandhi said, Gandhi glorify Ram Suraj, but I want to ask at that time, which powerful caste and who dominate the village? And when we see history, Shaumara, who was the king of Kollapur, the Brahmin also discriminated with him, trying to show that he is a Brahmin and he is more, valuable hai than Shau Maharaj.
No, but Gandhi was not even a Brahmin.
No, he is Vaishya.
Vaishya, yeah.
So what how I am could saying, Gram Swaraj ka jo concept tha, to at that time when we see the history, who is a powerful caste or a powerful people in village?
What is the question?
The question is basically looking at the entire thing through the lens of caste. Mm. And all the questions are all integrated. Mm. And this particular question says that he is praising Gram Swaraj. But however, the villages are riven with caste difference. So doesn't that mean that Gandhi is a caste difference?
No, but
I think that's the
but you have to take Gandhi's other thing on caste, what he said on Gram Swaraj. Gram Swaraj, they didn't mean to say that the same situation should continue. He wanted complete equality between all sections of society, irrespective of religion or of caste, that everyone would be, individual and be personally empowered. Until then, for instance, in Gram Swaraj, women had no voice at all. Women had no voice in the country. The only thing they were allowed to do really was to look after their husbands very carefully, produce the children, bring them up, go to the village market, the village temple. The question of taking part in any political activity just didn't arise. I remember when I grew up, for the first time there was a woman in our community called Mary Brito, I still remember her name, who came out marching with the men on the street. My God, the comments about her. My woman has gone mad. She's become like a public woman, walking with the men on the street. This was the situation in an educated town like Mangalore. Can you imagine what it was in the villages? Now, in a country like this, Gandhi has brought the women out in their hundreds, all over the country. Initially, they came as volunteers in Congress, at Congress meetings. Later on, they became, they became their own type of soul force warriors, giving hiding some of these people, Usha Mehta, set up a revolutionary radio in India somewhere, all by herself, she and some other young woman. Incredible. That is why when independence came, there was not the slightest question that women would have the right to vote. In Britain, in the US, they had to fight for almost 60 or 70 years. In Britain, for 30. In fact, the first time Gandhi saw non-violent struggle was in London with the suffragettes. So there's a great deal of struggle, and here people have got it overnight, all because of Gandhi, because he brought them out. And it was a very clever thing of him, because when you are doing a non-violent struggle, numbers are your only strength. He said, we can't leave half of India's population out. He brought them out from the very beginning. And he also realized that his whole doctrine of non-violence would be understood easier by India's women than by India's men, who were quite rough and violent. And it worked. In the very first cabinet, there were women ministers. Yeah, okay, I think. But I'm absolutely amazed and heartwarmed at the amount of interest, yes, you have shown in this old man.
They started 40 minutes late and we are
we have made up the time. God be praised.
So thank you very much. Wonderful. And the fact that you decided to follow your heart and follow up on Gandhi and actually contributed to Gandhi's international, your translation.
Yes.
Others in the world also are knowing much more about you. You publicized Gandhi and also you said that you wanted to do this.
You had met me when the first book came out. Well, one thing I might mention here that for 12 of the European edition, the language edition of the book, you know, the foreword has been written by former Soviet President Gorbachev. And really, it's amazing for someone brought up in his entire life in the communist ideology to write an editorial on Gandhi the way he has. But he has said that he now, after all these, has come to believe that non-violent conflict resolution is the only thing that can save this world.
So we have to keep on learning from this great, great man.
Yes.
And so much he has given. And as you said, his life was his message. Many things that he saw in his own time have gone, the times have changed, but the method remains.
Very
pointing
much,
that out, that the eternal part of Gandhi, we thank you very much.
Thank you.
So there are a few extra copies of the book. If anybody wants to buy,